I'm sorry, so sorry, that I was such a fool.
Folks, in an unprecedented move, I am starting the recording with the Department of Corrections. Got a very big error to come clean on this week. Or some might say a very small error. No, I'd say very big error. That's got a sizable error last week on the show. I said something about recalling that actor Colin Farrell had a sex tape in which people made fun of him for having a small hog. And folks, as it turns out, it is a nice hog. I misremembered.
I'm glad that you went back and re-educated yourself.
I think that what happened was that I thought it was small because I was looking at my own penis at the same time.
Yeah, that's probably what happened.
I was looking back and forth like, man, yeah, small penis.
Yeah, you've thrown the scale off.
I don't know why, but as soon as
why do more people when they make their sex films, why don't they hold a crisp dollar bill next to their Johnson?
Just a banana for scale, yeah. Just
no, I don't want a banana. They might get one of those fancy little tiny bananas that they've got at the store that has
Little red bananas.
Uh-huh.
I don't understand why more celebrities don't do what Screech did in their sex tape and clearly use a fake penis that they only ever stick out of their unzipped jeans.
Mm-hmm.
I started to say I don't know why I felt immediately compelled to double check my facts when I was editing the podcast and saw, oh wait, am I right about that? I better look up what Colin Farrell's dick looked like. And it was in the news. Apparently he saw Ewan McGregor's cock recently and was like, I thought mine was big, folks. So yeah, I guess that's I felt like because it was in the news again, I was gonna have to come clean before someone read that news story and then wrote in like, you know,
yeah,
I was wrong. And I'm a big enough man to admit it.
It's always best to get out ahead of these things.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want that Colin Farrell penis size blowback at me.
I don't want that penis coming at me. Happy birthday, America. It's the 4th of July. And much like an elderly grandparent, we're celebrating because this might be the last birthday they ever have.
Yeah. Do you think that somebody's going to do that cruel joke where they put, what, like 270 candles on the cake, mm-hmm. or give or
just
take?
Just cover that thing, and we're gonna get America a card that says "Over the Hill," mm. and then they open it up, and inside there's one of those fake prank lottery tickets.
Mm, yeah, we're doing everything we can to push them over the edge. Yeah, I'm gonna give Uncle Sam's oxygen canister an extra twist today. Yeah. You know, we want to get loopy.
We're all going over for ice cream with America at the nursing home, and then ice cream goes to bed early. America goes to bed early, and then we're all like, I don't know, do you want to go out to the bar now? America's asleep. Let's all go share stories about how we remember back in the day when America was still had a spring in its step, and you'd like to take its dog Freckles out to the park, and sometimes as a joke, he'd put a little toothpaste on Freckles' nose and then watch Freckles lick.
Oh, yeah.
America was a hell of a country once upon a time. I remember America had this big old Buick, used to drive around in it when we were kids. We'd all pile into the backseat of America's Buick, and we'd go down to the ice cream shop.
Now, what'd you get at the ice cream shop?
I mean, it was just one of those places that had the chocolate and vanilla and swirl.
Oh, okay. Swirl, then, I'm guessing.
Yeah. For a while, they didn't allow swirl. America wouldn't allow any swirling, but finally they came around with the times and said, okay, chocolate and vanilla can swirl together now.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes I wish that they had more flavors for the soft serve machines just because they can do the swirl. I mean, I want some odd combos, you know.
Oh, sometimes they do have different soft serve. They have that one that has like some sort of a fruit jam like swirled into it. You know what I'm talking about? Have you ever had that stuff?
I've had like the ones that have, it's just vanilla, but it has a ribbon of flavor along the edges of the vanilla.
Yeah,
it's like a synthetic weird thing where the one machine can make 16 different flavors.
Yeah, I don't know how they do that.
When my dad had his heart attack when I was a kid, they had that machine in the hospital.
What?
I was like, Dad, you stay as long as you need. you got to rest up and get real strong. They're going to take good care of you. I'll be here every day.
I'm just going to, here, I smuggled you in some bacon.
Yeah.
We're going to keep you here for a good long time. America, it's been a hell of a ride. But now, what do? We got to find a new grandparent, I guess.
Yeah. Somebody's got to learn how to play taps on a bugle.
Mm.
I knew how to do it on a flutophone once upon a time, but I never got into much bugling.
I'm at America's Funeral and I'm holding the bugle, but I'm like kind of just trying to fake it, like doing the, you know, just blowing. Mm-hmm. People are like, it's so soft. We know you're not blowing into that bugle. I also don't know the melody to Taps. I'm just all over the place. You're making a mockery of the death of America. I'm being ushered away by Al Franken. I don't know. I was just trying to think of a man who would be offended on behalf of this great nation. And I thought of elder statesman Al Franken.
Did you kind of think when he had his whole deal a few years ago that this is just what we needed so we could get a few more Stewart movies?
Oh, you mean like that when they canceled him for taking a picture where he was pretending like he was going to honk a woman's breasts, that they would say they wouldn't completely cancel him. He had ascended to a higher echelon of power. So he just gets knocked back down a peg like an ingredient in Burger Time. He drops back down a level.
That's and exactly now what I thought would happen.
Making bad feature films as Stuart Smalley. Yeah, kind of surprised there.
It also just seemed like that character could maybe have helped him grow, but I guess it could have done that in the first place.
What if they did that? What if this the January 6th, whatever, is it a trial? What are they doing? It kind of seems like they're just being mad
about it. I don't think that
it.
They are capable of, I think that they need the Department of Justice to bring any charges forward, but I think that there was even some quibbling about whether they would recommend charges be brought. So
yeah,
it
kind of seems like they just wanted to have some people get up and gossip about how he throws ketchup. Also, man, if you put one president in jail, people are going to want to go back and look at what other presidents did, and all the other presidents are like, no, we will not be putting presidents in jail, my good men. But what if they were like, we find Donald J. Trump guilty of sedition and treason and conspiracy to have other people kill the vice president, and as your punishment, you must go back to hosting The Apprentice on NBC. Yeah.
Do you think that Al Franken will win this season?
Al Franken, yeah. He has to be on it.
Yeah.
That would, oh my God.
Have a series of The Apprentice where every single contestant is canceled. And the reward is that they get uncanceled.
They could bring back Rod Blagojevich, Madison Cawthorn. He's in the mix this year. Just all disgraced politicians.
And just like everyone is terrified of Kevin Spacey.
Ooh, what about
he is the favorite in the clubhouse.
Kevin Spacey hosts an all-new reality show where disgraced former politicians all compete to become the mayor of a small town in Montana. And you have Nancy Pelosi, or not Nancy Pelosi. What's that other lady? From Alaska.
Oh, from Alaska? Former vice presidential candidate?
Mm-hmm.
What is her name?
What is her name? It's Sarah Palin.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, she's on an episode. She comes in and she's like, okay, now we need you guys to decorate our town for a parade. And they all form teams. And we're going to put up bunting and sparklers.
Donald Trump's the prettiest homecoming the moose ever had. Meese.
Yeah, it's a parade for the town moose. He's the moose from that show Northern Exposure.
Yeah,
He lives in the town and every year they throw a parade in his honor. Thank you for representing us on television, Mr. Moose. They treat him like some sort of a god.
Mm-hmm. Everyone including has to bring making sacrifices.
Do you have an idea for a podcast? What
I
are we
do.
Doing?
This one, we're gonna have to put our tinfoil caps on for this one. It's called "Untangling the Dang Spider Web of Deceit."
Untangling the Dang Spider Web
of Deceit, and we'll just be getting a daily newspaper and just making connections, informing ourselves. Noticing that if A, then B, this is what is truly happening in the world and in our backyard. Maybe it's as simple as we see that someone's VHS tape collection was stolen. We see that also in the want ads, someone is trying to sell a bunch of VHS tapes. Could be that easy. It could be a situation where I will take the money and I will follow the money and you're going to be looking for breadcrumbs and we'll diverge and come back together after we have gone through the whole paper. I think we're probably going to need some different colors of yarn and push pins for this one.
Yeah, you follow the money and I'll quo bono or whatever it is. Is it quo? Quo bono sounds like one of the guys on Jabba's sail barge. I feel like I'm saying it wrong.
There's pro bono just means for free.
Well, I'm not doing a pro bono. No, I think it's where it's like who profits. That's where you're looking for who's got something to gain from this.
I'm starting to realize before we can do the show properly, we might have to do a remedial Latin episode.
Yeah. Oh, what if we did an episode all in Latin just for the old time Catholics?
Oh, well, unfortunately, the only Latin I know how to speak is pig Latin.
Oh, what if we did something for the pig Catholics?
Yeah, they're going to love it.
It's like some little Mediterranean island where they have a different version of Catholicism called pig Catholicism.
I mean, it already sounds like an improvement to me.
It's their whole thing. They're like they're one of those Gnostic Christian sects that mm-hmm. was founded by the farmer whose pigs were all chased off a cliff by Jesus.
I don't know. I was thinking it was going to be kind of like that Moose is to Alaska, where they feed the pig all the wine.
Oh yeah, and something about the island's government. They, for some reason, back in like the 1600s, the town charter said something about that they had to have a pig as the cardinal of the church in the town, mm-hmm. and so they just have a pig with one of those funny hats.
Do you think that you get like a cute little teacup kind of pig, or do you think it's the biggest, baddest pig in the land?
From what I understand, teacup pigs are a scam.
Okay.
They sell you a very small baby pig, and then it just turns into a normal pig, and then you're stuck with a giant pig in your house.
Oh, man. Well, I say we go with the biggest, baddest pig in the land. I nominate Bebop from the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for pig.
I nominate that big balloon from the Pink Floyd, you know.
Also a very good choice.
Very big pig. It comes rising up over the horizon every morning, and everyone has to like bow down on their little prayer mats and pray to the... We've created a cult. They only think they're Catholics.
What does one have to fulfill to be a full Catholic? They're one of the denominations that's like, we're pretty much exactly Catholic. It's just...
Oh, yeah. There's like the Church of England, right? They still have like all the...
It's just Catholic with divorces, right?
Right. I think that they also don't... they aren't crazy about Mary or any of the other like saints. That's the big thing with
the Catholics. They just worship the very pig-like Henry VIII.
Yeah. Okay, I got an idea.
All right.
This is a podcast called An Hour of Howling Winds and Bitter Groans.
Okay.
That's it. It's just like, so it'd be like, we'd add like just some, like a full hour long, just... Whoa. No, no, my baby.
Oh,
I stubbed my toe.
They should give me all my money back. It's not my fault. I didn't know that buying 500,000 lottery tickets was a bad investment.
Oh, they've stolen my Bored Ape. All of my apes gone. I mean, you get the idea.
Do you think that we'll get chapped? Wind chapped?
Oh, we could. I mean, we could add in some like, oh no, I'm being chapped.
Yeah. Now, why, when the wind chaps at all, do they only make the tiny stick of the chapstick? Can you not get a chap block?
A chap block?
Yeah, chap so stick. Just rub it on your cheeks.
Right. There's actually, if you know where to go, you could actually get the whole chap log that Ooh. They break the chap sticks off of.
Do you just make some chap chips off the chap log?
Yeah.
However much you need at that current time.
The chap stick factory, there's a guy whose whole job is just to go around sweeping up all the chap dust
mm-hmm.
at the chap mill. This is a great imaginary world we've created where chap stick is a tree.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. People are going to be talking about this episode for years to go. Oh, the one where they do the whole thing about the chap tree.
Yeah. It'll probably go down in history, but do you think that there's anything illicit about the chap trees? Like do they only grow in one part of the world and there's some sort of monopoly of the chap trees?
Oh yeah, it's like it's destroying the ecosystem and the economy mm-hmm. of, you know, like quinoa where it's like, oh yeah, no, that stuff is terrible for the people who live where it's grown in the Andes Mountains or whatever. And I guess it would be somewhere like up in the north, you know, in the tundra would be where the chap trees grow. Right.
Oh yeah. It's really hard. You actually have to use axes and stuff to cut them down. And then once you get them to a warmer climate, it warms up and becomes the chapstick we know and love and have based our economy upon.
Well, for thousands of years, the Inuit people of Siberia have been using the chap tree as a natural remedy for chapped lips. And then we came along and just started harvesting it wholesale.
Hmm.
And there's, you know, this is a picture of the chap forest in 1800, and here it is today. And it's just that moose from the town. He's out there all by himself.
It's sort of similar to when they try to show you pictures of the polar ice caps melting, and you're like, I don't have a good frame of reference on this. I'll take your word for it.
Just a picture of a emaciated polar bear with the driest cracked lips you've ever seen.
Yeah, sometimes you miss the forest for the trees with these things. I like to have something smaller that I can emotionally connect to, like a bear with bloody lips, and not like seal blood. Like I can tell it's its own bear blood.
Yeah, sometimes you'll see a picture and then you go on Snopes and they're like, actually, this bear was just drinking blood as part of some sort of a ritual.
Mm-hmm. Honestly, you know, a lot of water around where the bears are at is already frozen. So having a warm drink, you pop a seal head off and take, you know, quaff your fill off that. Nice to have a warm, salty drink for the polar bear.
Yeah, nice big, a tall, steaming mug of seal blood.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk to me until I've had my seal blood. That's what all the polar bear's mugs say. That's an hour of howling winds and bitter groans. I don't know that there's much more to explain.
Do you think that it would help if, like, would we have some sort of job or some reason that we're out amongst the howling winds that we're bitterly moaning about?
Oh, maybe we're not doing the bitter groans. It's we're just trying to do a podcast. And you can just hear the howling winds and bitter groans in the background. But we're just like, we're reviewing new video games.
Okay. But there's we're doing it on a mountainside.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Today we're looking at the new expansion for Horizon Forbidden West. But then you hear, oh, help, help, I've fallen into a ravine. Or we could just be like reviewing like fast food sandwiches. Okay. We're reviewing fast food sandwiches. Please, please.
That's a wrinkle I haven't heard of before. Like a podcast that reviews both video games and fast food sandwiches.
Mm.
On a video dangerous games? Mountainside.
On a bitter, howling, wind-swept mountain.
Yeah, maybe it's... I was picturing, like, this is our Everest kind of thing, but maybe we're just in the moors of Scotland.
Hmm. Yeah. It could be anywhere, really. Out in the desert at night. Maybe there's little coyotes. You can hear them howling in the distance, too. And then we're getting stung by one of those whiptail scorpions. What are those things called?
I think you had it.
It's
a specific type of scorpion.
Maybe it's not a scorpion. It's something else. Anyway, it doesn't matter.
I'm glad that none of the scorpions that I've encountered in my life have had wings. You know, a lot of bugs, you got a winged variant.
Oh, it's called a
vinegar. It always makes them. Go ahead.
A vinegaroon. That's what I was thinking of.
Yes, I have heard of that before.
It's like a lobster.
That's what an awful name.
It's a lobster that shoots acid. Boy, oh boy. I'd rather not do a podcast with those around.
Yeah.
No, thank you.
That makes two of us.
You got another podcast idea?
Yes, I do. This one is called The Suggestion Box, which this would be a podcast. On this very podcast, we have a variation of a suggestion box. I'm not saying that we would just rely on you, the listener, to make a show for us. I'm saying that I am not opposed to going around town and wherever I find a suggestion box, jimmying that son of a bitch open and seeing what people have to say.
Ooh, so this would be like where we gain access to other suggestion boxes.
Yes.
And then we, yeah. I'm sure that there's some websites that don't have very good security that we could probably access. Mm-hmm. Some sort of a Excel spreadsheet that.
Yeah, well, you're talking over my head right now. I was picturing physical boxes that I can force open and then get my grubby little hands on people's secret missives. They're helpful suggestions, and there's probably going to be a lot of complaining. Have you ever been at a workplace that uses the suggestion box?
Yes. Yes, I have.
It's a weird thing.
Yeah, I feel like the only times that I can remember there being a suggestion box, it was no one used it because any time that it did get used, the management could tell who had made the suggestion.
Yes.
And was mad about it.
That's exactly correct. In no way have, for about 2.5 years, I would go to a monthly meeting in which they would take them out. And the best case scenario is that it's a pretty benign thing and they don't know exactly who wrote it. And they're just like, yeah, that's an okay idea. And then do nothing about it. But in general, yes, there should be a healthy amount of paranoia that people have before they put anything in a suggestion box, because it can only count against you.
We've got one here that says we would like to have a 401k. Now, what we've been talking about is very similar to this, but it's kind of like a health savings account. We're just going to take more of your money, and you can have it back when you get old. But we're going to hang on to it for you. We're not going to invest it.
Then they all look at each other and do that thing where they touch the side of their nose.
The Great Escape music starts playing. All the managers are.
Yeah, Marvin Hamlish plays a jangling ragtime tune.
Yeah.
We all dance out of the manager's office.
They're up to something. The suggestion box. We could also go around adding suggestions to suggestion boxes as a way of running interference for the actual employees. But we have to be careful.
Sticking union question mark into all of the boxes.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Yeah. So we have to be careful that we don't say something so inflammatory that they just decide to like do a scorched earth campaign on the employees of the business. We don't need to go into a Heine Brothers.
Yeah.
And get everyone fired.
Yeah, that wasn't my intent. I guess we do need to be careful because I was, you know, just going to rip these boxes open, grab everything in there and run. But if I'm sneaky about it and there isn't a crazed man who did this, somebody who works there will probably get blamed. So that's not good.
Yeah.
So I want to have eyes on me while I do this.
Just dropping a card in the suggestion box that says, dump them out.
Yeah, yeah.
The manager's
and then also pulling a crowbar from behind my back, prying the top of the box off and stealing my own suggestion.
You chicken out. Oh. I changed my mind. I don't want to see the manager's titties. All right, I got another one here.
Okay.
This one's called The Rebels in the Retails.
Okay.
Parenthesis. A guide to doing a bad job at a bad job.
That's helpful, I think, information.
We both have experience with this. You have a job where you don't care about it and you kind of wish that they would fire you, but you also don't want to get fired. So you're just kind of, you're surfing that wave, right? you're right on that edge of like just being a terrible employee, but not so terrible that they think they'd be better off without you. But yeah, usually it is like a retail type situation.
You know, stealing a little bit here and there, but not ever going for broke.
Yeah, just help yourself to a little bit of a little bit of candy that they sell at the counter, but don't walk out with a PlayStation.
Yeah, they got Post-it notes in here like they're growing on trees. I need some at home.
They're like, hey, well, how come there are all these Hershey bar wrappers next to your workstation? Are you eating the Hershey bars that we have for sale? And you're like, no, I packed my lunch today. I packed a whole bag of Hershey bars.
You know me. I eat the same thing for lunch every day.
Six Hershey's.
Yep.
They're like, why is the whole section of Hershey's in this checkout counter empty? Oh, a guy came in, he stole them all.
Yeah, he ripped open the suggestion box too.
He came in here,
made off with all that.
Here's the card he put in. It says, "More Hershey bars."
Yeah, very rude. Didn't even say please.
You rob a bank and then you drop a note in the suggestion box that says, "We should not prosecute bank robbers." Just my two cents.
Yeah. How long did it take bank robbers to realize that they should not wear that striped robber uniform that they were giving themselves away before the crime had even been perpetrated?
The little raccoon mask?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, like the Hamburglar, I guess. But, you know, he's a burgling variant that only burgles burgers. That was a classic costume that all criminals wore at once upon a time.
I feel like that the striped pajamas was originally like a prison uniform, right?
Yep. Maybe they just didn't give him a change of clothes when they got out.
And
they,
yeah, this guy's so addicted to hamburgling.
The recidivism is so bad that they aren't even getting a change of clothes before they're getting thrown back in.
He's been out on the street for 10 minutes. He's already back to his old tricks. It's also interesting that the Hamburglar, when he goes to prison, they give him the striped uniform and a cape. They were like, all right, welcome to jail. Here's, put on your clothes. All right, bend over. We're going to check your butthole. All right, now here's your little yellow cape.
Yeah, do you think it was a burn like your mommy's special boy, and you get a special cape? He's back again, the prodigal son. He's got
that one tooth in his mouth. That's a weird part about the Hamburglar, right?
Yeah, it doesn't look like he could rightly chew up a burger.
He has a little baby, cartoon baby's mouth with one tooth.
Do you think he's eating those burgers, not unlike today's 4th of July? They had the hot dog eating competition. Do you think he does that thing where they dip it in water to soften it up?
Yeah, it's like when a dog steals your food, and the worst part about you set down your plate and then you go, oh, I forgot to get a drink. And you go back to the kitchen and open the fridge, and then you hear the sound of something going on. And you run back in the room and the dog has taken your hamburger and he's just choking on it, just trying to eat it as fast as he can.
He's waterboarding himself with a hamburger.
It's like, you're not even like, I would be less mad if you were like just slowly, sumptuously eating this hamburger and really enjoying it. But instead, you're making a mockery of the whole concept of eating.
What if he was eating it like a super fancy boy and pulled out a knife and fork?
Can you imagine, like, are there people out there who feed their animals different meals? Like, do meal planning?
I'm absolutely sure that there are.
It's interesting to think about. Like, a dog who has a better life than I do.
Yeah.
Now I'm bummed out. Because I know there, like, are dogs that have it better than me.
Yeah, but those dogs, that like, I guess it's a situation where they need less to be fulfilled than you do as a man.
It's true.
So they are happier. But if you had your human mind within the body of that dog, I think you'd probably get bored pretty fast.
It's true. Yeah. I guess what I want is to be a man with the mind of a dog and not a dog with the mind of a man.
I don't want that. I changed my mind. I was about to say I was going to sign up for the dog brain transplant as well, but no.
Yeah. What do you think? Maybe Joey Chestnut is a dog trapped in a man's body, and that's why he eats hot dogs so fast.
Yes.
That would be I think Joey Chestnut follows us on Instagram. Maybe we could get him. We'll get a pitch meeting with him for our origin story movie, yeah, where he Freaky Fridays with a dog and there's a dog somewhere.
Maybe he had a dog sensei who taught him
the
way to eat.
People love a good dog movie. What if it's a movie about Joey Chestnut growing up and his dog can't stop eating hot dogs? Yeah. And then that's how he learns. And then the dog tragically dies at the end.
Okay. I've got a casting idea for the voice of Joey Chestnut's dog sensei. Charles Barkley.
Ooh. Holy hell. What a movie.
Yeah.
Is it going to be one of those things where like Homeward Bound, where the dogs just, do we hear the dog's inner voice, or is this going to be more like,
yes,
where
absolutely, because every dog has the superpower to eat hot dogs like that. So we don't need to do any CGI with this, and it just scratches an itch that they don't scratch anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a big, inflamed welt on the side of America that needs a good scratching. And I miss the days of them just filming a dog and giving its internal monologue voice.
Mm-hmm. And of course we will end up embroiled in some sort of a scandal when footage is released from the set of Joey Chestnut Origins, where we just force fed a dog hot dogs until it was sick.
That's and then, the beauty of dogs. You don't have to force feed them. They'll do it to themselves.
But what I'm saying
is, I'm just going to place this tray of 70 hot dogs over here. I sure hope nothing happens. Roll film.
Oh, I was going to suggest that we do a little bit of movie magic and fill the dog with hot dogs and then film him throwing them up and then just run it in reverse. So it just looks like he's hoovering them into his mouth at an incredible rate of speed. Yeah. But I guess it would be better if we didn't get in trouble with the Humane Society. But then again, what good animal movie doesn't get in trouble with the Humane Society? I guess I just want to be in good company.
I don't know. Milo, I feel like the Humane Society might be open to, maybe I leave an envelope on your desk and you just let us force feed these dogs a bunch of dogs.
Oh, maybe
it's more very PETA I'm worried about.
But, oh, yeah.
You know, they've got that big ocean liner, so as long as we do it inland somewhere, I think we'll be safe.
Maybe we get in cahoots with PETA and we just give the dog veggie hot dogs. He doesn't get real hot dogs.
Oh, unbelievable dogs.
Unbelievable dogs.
I wonder if I wonder if Nathan's has considered unbelievable dogs for the... Probably not.
Unbelievable dogs.
You know, it would be more inclusive. There'd be more eaters eligible for their competition if they did.
Wait, is there actually a brand called Unbelievable Dogs, or are you thinking of Impossible Dogs?
I figured they'd want their own branding, obviously.
Okay, I was like, oh... The Incredulous Burger, Gobsmacked Chicken Nuggets.
Mm-hmm. Spectacular Spaghetti.
Wait, they made a different kind of spaghetti?
It's just gluten-free. That's it.
What if we made a product called Evil Spaghetti and it was made from meat?
Most spaghetti, you've got to put the sauce on it to make it look bloody. This spaghetti looks bloody out of the box.
I guess what I'm describing is just ground beef. Like, it comes out in those little spaghetti strands, and it's soaked in blood.
It's like a chicken fry. It's a beef noodle.
Beef noodles.
Yeah.
I think that there already is a thing called beef noodles, so...
Okay.
We'll have to either go to war with the big beef noodle industry or... All right, let's go to the hotline.
Okay.
Folks, if you have an idea for a podcast, you can reach out to us at the podcast hotline, 702-PODCASP, or 702-763-2277, or email us at wedonthaveapodcastyet@gmail.com. Leave us a message. Here's our message this week.
My name is Tammy Parker.
Go ahead.
All right.
Oh.
That was it.
That was it. Tammy Parker.
My name is Tammy Parker. My name is Tammy Parker. My name is Tammy Parker.
Oh, no.
My name is Tammy Parker.
What's going on?
My name is Tammy Parker.
I don't know how to make it stop.
My name is Tammy Parker.
Okay, there we go. Holy hell. My name is Tammy Parker. This could be, I don't know. Could be like a fun thing, like that show, My Name is Earl.
Yeah. Yeah. And do you remember that old phrase that, you know, like your grandma might have said, where they call somebody a nosy Parker?
Uh huh.
Maybe Tammy wasn't so much calling to leave a message, as much as she wanted to find out all about our business and sell us something, trying to be a nosy Parker.
She's playing hard to get.
Oh.
We're going to have to call
like that
back
idea better.
And be like, hello, is Tammy Parker there? I don't know. Who's asking? This is the sweet boys of We Don't Have a Podcast Yet. Oh, well.
Oh, how'd you get this number?
Oh, I don't know if I've ever heard of you. I talk to lots of podcasts.
Mm-hmm. You know, there are four or five podcasts I know of that they secretly admire me. Are you one of those?
We're Tammy.
We're just returning phone calls. We have to do this all the time.
We call up all aggressive. Who is this? You ever get one of those? Somebody calls you because they got like a robocall from your number, and then they're like mad and they won't believe that you didn't call them.
No, I've never had that happen to me. Precisely that.
I have on two separate occasions. One time I was just like, oh no, this is one of those things where somebody's using people's phone numbers to make spam calls. Mm-hmm. And the person was like, huh? And I was like, all right, well, whatever, goodbye. And the other time, the guy got really aggressive. And so I was like, you know what? You tell me where you are. I'm going to come and kick your ass.
Oh, that's fun to do. Especially when they don't know where you are. Just set up a meet for your fight.
Yeah.
Don't go.
Just be like, meet me in the Shoney's parking lot. They're driving
around. How will I know it's you? Because I'll be wearing the goddamn Shoney Bear costume, motherfucker.
The 8 o'clock news. Shoney Bear is hospitalized after a random man attacked him in the parking lot of Shoney's. He is still at large at this time. If anyone else looks like Shoney Bear, please.
Yeah.
Please seek shelter in place.
I think that might actually be the nom de plume I use for when I go stuffing these suggestion boxes.
Shoney Bear?
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, it's me, Shoney Bear. Can we have a union?
Also, I'm going to have to make a deal with the Shoney Corporation because I would like to publish novels under the name Shoney Bear.
Is Shoney still in business?
Oh, I think they're holding on by a thread. I don't see them very, very much anymore. And which ones were able to weather the pandemic? I don't know.
Yeah. That maybe that's what we do. We find like a defunct corporate mascot and then we reinvent them as something
Okay, so you're saying getting a completely, because I don't think the Shoney is, Shoney Bear is completely defunct, but he's mostly defunct. We would be refuncting Shoney Bear. You're talking about getting somebody who's been out of business for a while where we can snap up, shoot.
Like Burger Chef and Jeff.
Yeah.
And we're like, they love unions. And the guy who owned Burger Chef is like, no, but he can't do anything because he sucked too bad at his burger restaurant and they went out of business. Burger Chef and Jeff. Burger Chef loves unions. And Jeff supports sex workers. No! The founder of Burger Chef in The Howling Winds. Yeah. No, they're reappropriating my mascots.
He sold out and bought himself like a Scottish keep. Like he's next door neighbors with Enya. He's just out there being really angry about what we've done to Burger Chef.
Every night, Mr. Burger Chef goes out on the roof of his castle and just screams. He's so mad about what they've done to his beautiful Burger Chef and Jeff. That's my name is Tammy Parker.
It's a good one.
Thank you, Tammy. If you have anything else to say, please call back, Tammy Parker. I would love to hear more about who you are. But now it's time to go to the Podtron 4500. Folks, Podtron 4500 is an artificial intelligence that we trained using the list of the most popular podcasts on the internet, and then it generates a list of new names that we can use as jumping off points. Podcast names like The White House Situation Room.
Oh my goodness. That's a serious one. And I know wear a shirt with a collar on it if we record this podcast.
We're all sitting around and we have the TV with the, you know, Joint Chiefs of Staff all calling in from different places. We're all tented fingers, patiently awaiting word from SEAL Team 6. They've done it. They've successfully crashed 2 Black Hawk helicopters.
Do you think anybody's ever been like, do you think we can get Snoop Dogg into the Joint Chiefs of Staff just because it would be really funny?
I'm sure that probably has happened.
Or Cheech and Chong. And or Cheech and or Chong.
Oh, the Joint Chiefs.
Yeah.
Ah. I just thought it would be funny if one of the Joint Chiefs of Staff was Snoop Dogg. The rest of them are all 5-star generals. All, Mr. President, we need to strike at the heart of this problem. We need to order a tactical strike. And then here's Snoop Dogg. He's doing his funny little dance with his little braids.
You can tell if he's feeling it or not. A lot of times he doesn't even have to say anything.
He doesn't say a word. You can just tell if the vibes are off. Snoop Dogg. He'll just get up and walk out.
And then all the other 5-star generals are all hemming and hawing and trying to get the vibe back right.
They're all smoking joints.
Yeah.
Trying to seem cool to the president. President's just watching Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg's outside just doing his little dance in the Rose Garden. President's at the window just watching Snoop Dogg. What is he doing? What do I need to do? How do I gain his approval?
Then he notices one of those generals is not inhaling. And you realize the problem.
There it is. The White House Situation Room. This is an actual room, right? This is like a thing in the White House, as I understand it.
Was the concept of a Situation Room introduced by Star Trek?
Was it?
I'm trying to remember the first time I heard the phrase Situation Room.
I mean, yeah, I guess.
I'm not even sure. I might be way off base with this. You might have to fact check me on this.
I mean, I can't picture George Washington saying the phrase situation room. Although
really,
I'm sure
really
they
I,
had
I
rooms.
Found that situations don't so much wait for you to get to a room.
Mm-hmm.
Usually when a situation arises, whatever room I'm in, I'm not like, dang it, I'm in the sunroom. This is all wrong.
Oh, no. There's not supposed to be a situation in this room. What if the situation room was like the danger room from X-Men? It's just the president has to, he goes in and then there's like flamethrowers shooting out of the walls.
He's just endlessly practicing his blind dates.
There's, yeah, babies. He has to kiss as many babies as he can, jump over like a big whirling blade.
Ooh.
Then he has to shake hands. There's a whole row of people he has to shake hands, but one of them is some sort of a pervert who's about to be exposed, and he has to be sure and not shake that one's hand when he's going down the line of handshakes.
Ooh.
The president, yeah, and then he reads off a teleprompter, but there's no punctuation, so he has to...
Do you think a good president can tell by someone's handshake whether they're of good stock?
Yeah, I'd say presidents seem to be a great judge of character based on...
Yeah, they definitely do.
Who they keep, their company they keep. Historically, I think these are real men of honor, great statesmen who don't associate with unseemly sorts. We love our presidents, folks.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that they should have made a sequel to Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, where Mr. Smith becomes president, and then they're just building Boy Scout camps all over the country, willy-nilly, and we're allocating far, far too much money to Boy Scout camps? We're like, there's like a Boy Scout camp for every 10 American citizens. This is run amok. We thought you were going to do good things, and it's one-track mind. Boy Scout camp this, Boy Scout camp that. We're ruined. It's all over now. Thanks a lot, Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith, you spent the entire Pentagon budget on Boy Scouts, on the little wooden car race. Now we have to send those scouts
He's
in their little wooden
cars. He's not
even listening.
He's looking at his compass.
He's sewing badges onto it. He's gave the first presidential sash. I was thinking maybe the White House Situation Room could be a podcast where we discuss what's going on with the infamous WhiteHouse.com.
Ooh.
Do you remember WhiteHouse.com? This was back in like the early days of the internet. If you went to WhiteHouse.com, it is probably the most famous cyber squatting website. Someone bought that domain back in like the 1990s and made it a porn site.
Because oh, it White still House... is.
But yeah, I just looked it up and it says, as seen on Fox News, yes. The New York Times, NBC News. But at the top it says, world's most famous adult and free speech site, relaunching June 2022. And I clicked 18 and over and it says, coming soon.
How did they spell coming?
They spelled it with an O. I know. But I'd like to point out that this is July 2022. So maybe this is the whole website. This is all we're getting.
I think it's just a little tease. You'll have to come back in probably June of 2023 to find out more.
I'm trying different URLs to see if there's anything. I'm trying whitehouse.com/index, whitehouse.com/home.
I'm going to try whitehouse.tv. I just want to see what they... Oh, no. Nobody's got that one.
Wait. No one has that one? Hang on a second.
All right.
Andrew? We could get whitehouse.boats for $15.
Dot boats? That's the best one!
Whitehouse.boats!
Now, is whitehouseboats.anything available? Maybe whitehouseboat.boat, perchance?
We can get... Here are some of the ones that are available. We could get whitehouse.contact. I feel like that one might get us in trouble. That's too close to seeming... But that's only $12. We can get whitehouse.rocks. Whitehouse. Whitehouse.football. Whitehouse.irish. Whitehouse.tips. Whitehouse.band. Let me see what the most expensive one we can get is. Let's see. 208. Whitehouse.fun. Whitehouse.movie. These are all 300. Okay. Most expensive one I can find is whitehouse.ooh. And that costs $1,054 plus a $26 a year fee.
Yeah. Oh, Whitehouse. I wouldn't even think to type that one in. Give me movie over ooh.
Whitehouse.uno.
And give me boat over both of them.
All right. I'm buying whitehouse.boat.
Yeah. Yeah, just think about you can now go to work and say like, "Yeah, I bought a boat this weekend."
Yeah,
you'll never guess what boat I bought. And then just don't answer any questions or show any pictures.
All right, here we go.
And it's just I love the idea of there being a White House boat. it's the way that presidents should live.
I'm sorry, this is going to take a moment. I'm purchasing whitehouse.boats.
Oh, it's plural even.
Yes.
Oh my goodness.
And we own whitehouse.boats.
Yeah.
Check it out, folks. Whitehouse.boats.
Like shooting fish in a barrel.
It's kinda, I wonder how long I will let this roll over every year and charge me another $15. Will it be 1 year? Will it be 20?
I don't know, but I think that we can probably start working on some content for whitehouse.boats. I'm trying to think what the best media to create a White House boat with. If it's a paper mache job, if it's a Lego job, maybe Kinex coated in paper mache. So you got a Kinect skeleton of the White House boat.
So you're
I want to give people a full tour of the boat.
This is all right. So we own a website now. But you're saying,
and it's got to be filled with White House boats.
You've already given up on the idea of building a website and you're moving on to building boats.
So that it's just going to be like a photo sharing website of my various White House boat models.
You know what's going to happen.
And other things, you know.
This is how we're going to become rich. The ice caps are melting. Sea levels are rising. The ocean is going to encroach in on Washington, D.C. And the president will be forced to live like Kevin Costner in Waterworld on the White House boat. And then he comes groveling to us. Please let us have White House dumb boats. Oh, well, it'll cost you $17 a year, Mr. President.
Okay, so you think that the bottom line for us is a little? I was suggesting that we would do this, and then become the premier people to go to for all of your houseboat questions, and probably the organizers and corrupt profiteers that finally create Houseboat City, down in the Gulf of Mexico.
I mean, that's fine if you want to do that, but this is where you and I will part ways like Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak.
Okay.
I will be going on
to with just your healthy $2 a year profit to bigger and better things. I'll not be like, houseboat related.
Hey, look at this keen watch that I got. And you're like dying because you just ate fruit instead of getting your cancer treated. But people are going to make movies about you. He's the man who made the White House boats.
Yeah. All right, do you think that Steve Jobs was ever mad that Ricky Gervais stole his I'm going to wear a black shirt to everything thing?
Well, Steve Jobs wore a long sleeve black shirt or a turtleneck. Mm-hmm. Ricky Gervais is one of those special kind of European guys like Simon Cowell who wears a shirt that is slightly too tight for his old man body because it thinks it gives him sex appeal.
Okay, that's fair. That's fair.
I would like to see Steve Jobs brought back from the dead with the same technology that they used to bring back Tupac. But now he's wearing a too tight short sleeve shirt.
I mean, you could make him wear anything you want. He's got a real stick him in a Shoney Bear costume.
He's got Daisy Dukes. He's wearing Crocs. It is a real
dump
tight...
him out. Come on, Steve Jobs.
Dump him out. All right. Do you have an idea from the Podtron?
I do. This one is called Giant Robot Fist Fight.
Oh.
Which is, it's kind of like, well, I don't know if these robots, you remember that Hugh Jackman movie, Real Steel?
Yes.
I think this is like, okay, guys, I know you tried to relaunch BattleBots and that was all right. I think it's time we up the ante a little bit. And I think we're ready for full on robotic boxing. And I think that we're going to get out ahead of it, kind of like we did with the houseboats. And we can be the official podcast of the Giant Robot Boxing League, the GRBL.
I feel like this
Grabble.
Is... Yeah, the Grabble.
Yeah.
Grabble.com. Let me check and see if it's... Oh, we're going to have to get Grabble.bus.
That's not a bus I want to get on.
The Grabble bus.
Yeah.
It's like the Bang bus, but you get on and then immediately a bunch of robots start punching you. In the techno future, the robot's favorite website is Grabble.bus. They get off on it, seeing a little meat man being pummeled to death by other robots.
Well, I mean, people always get off of the bus.
I like the idea of Giant Robot Fist Fight because I think that the problem with the battle bots is similar to the problem with the mixed martial arts, which is that there turns out to be one strategy that works the best, and then everyone starts using that strategy if there aren't more limitations.
Yeah, everybody tries to hit you with a giant spinning saw wheel.
I think
either or.
It's all the robots now just try and flip the other robots.
That's
They're all
true.
Just like spatula robots. And all of the mixed martial arts guys just try and like bear hug each other until they pass out.
And somehow I think that by combining those two sports, we're going to arrive at a happy medium, because the robots in the robot boxing league, you know, they're not going to be able to flip each other.
Yeah, it's just
no spatula bots, but also they're not going to have the points of articulation possible to just turn it into a grappling on the ground sort of sport. It will remain rock'em sock'em robots, but just
that's
real.
Right. The rock'em sock'em robots' legs don't move.
And also, it was a movie that everybody shat on when it came out, but Real Steel, I've watched it like 3 times in my life, and it's always a good time.
You know, I haven't watched it in a while. Maybe I need to revisit Real Steel.
I mean, it's not great, but they don't make that movie anymore, and it was a fun father-son stupid movie that's... It's all right.
I do recall that they did spend a lot of time reaching for explanations for why and how this robot fighting world works. And also that for some reason, Hugh Jackman's accent was especially bad in that movie. It was like,
yeah, he like was not trying very hard in that one.
They were like, he's like, listen, you can pay me $1 million and I'll do a perfect American accent, or you can pay me $300,000 and I'll kind of drift in and out.
I hope that his agent argued for more, because that was like in the heat. Like he was pretty much doing a Wolverine movie every 2 years at that point.
Did you see
like
that?
I think that Hugh Jackman could have got a little more scratch than that. And if they lowballed him like that, good for him for not just even phoning trying. It in.
Did you see that where there was like some investigative journalist that, as part of some larger investigation, like leaked a bunch of like people's demands on like movie projects, like actors, like what it was in their rider, basically, like, yeah. Oh, I get to have my own hair and makeup person, and I get, you know, I get
no brown M&Ms, etc.
The funniest one though was Al Pacino had written to some director and was like, I'm not gonna do an A. I'm gonna do like a C, B minus job.
That is
incredible. He told him, we're gonna shoot for a B minus, maybe a C with this performance.
I like the idea of Al Pacino's, you know how you have a different voice in writing than you do when you're having a conversation with somebody?
Mm-hmm.
I like the idea that Al Pacino internalized his character from Scent of a Woman so much that is still who he is when he's writing text messages.
Yeah.
Demands for his writer.
I'm going to do somewhere between a B and a C on this one. God, imagine you hire Al Pacino. He shows up and he's like, this one's going to be a D minus.
Yeah.
I'm just going to skate by with a
diploma.
There's
going to be no pizza party at the end of this shoot.
All right. I got another podcast idea from the Podtron.
Okay.
This one's called Real Bigger Franken Podcast.
Ooh, that's a good one.
This is, I think Franken Podcast, we need to steer clear of former U.S. Senator Al Franken. I think he is being rehabilitated, but...
That's not the name of the monster. That's the name of the senator.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. You're thinking of... That's Senator Al Franken. You're thinking of Senator Al Franken's monster.
Yeah. So as long as we just dwell upon his creation... I think we can steer it so that we don't bring all glory to him.
Okay. I was kind of just thinking that we could piece together a Franken podcast where we take pieces of other podcasts, maybe deceased podcasts.
That's much
we dig them
idea.
Up and we make a Franken podcast out of podcasts that have passed on and no longer with us.
We did something similar once before, but the results I thought were quite good. I think that we need to do this one where they're more recently departed. Like, we need to get to those podcasts while their bodies are still fresh.
Yeah, so we have to be able to put them in the big table and then strike them with lightning and bring them, reanimate them.
I feel like when we attempted something like this before, it was more akin to podcast taxidermy.
It was like we were at the podcast morgue, mm-hmm. with our little tape recorder, like opening up the podcast and being like, and the subject only recorded two episodes. They were 15 minutes long. And they said, I'm going to be giving away an iPad. And then they never.
And I was like, looky over here. This podcast looks just like my mother's podcast.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take it.
This one, we would be taking elements of these podcasts. Maybe we could even use like bigger podcasts instead of just ones that were small failures that fell by the wayside, never to be noticed. This one, we could take like big ones. What's a podcast that doesn't exist anymore? Did Robin Williams have a podcast?
The Ricky Gervais Show.
Ricky Gervais. We could take Ricky Gervais's podcast. And who else? Who's someone who's recently been jailed? or canceled?
Randy Quaid never had a podcast, did he?
He had like a bunch of Facebook Live videos of his like insane rambling screeds.
That doesn't count. Come on, Randy, get it together. And you know, at this point, it that ship might have already sailed. Check out whitehouse.boats, Randy. but also, come on. You had an audience that was clamoring for you for your podcast. That was how you. I don't know. It's not very hard. Get it together, Randy. Dennis, help your brother out.
Dennis, get in there. Your brother needs you. Just Dennis Quaid showing up at Randy's house with a little Zoom recorder.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to get you through this, brother. All right. Do you got another one?
Yep. This one's called Shortcuts.
That's it? Just Shortcuts?
Yep. And I think that's, you know, mostly what it is I'm going to log how long it takes me to get around places and try to build a more efficient route than what my Google Maps or my Waze or whatever.
Yeah.
Cutting to the chase all by myself with a map. Table.
Somewhere I have like a half finished notebook of ideas for a book that I wanted to write about how to drive that would include things that they don't teach you in school, like how to identify a car that is going to take off faster from a red light when it turns green and get behind the car that's going to move out of that stop, out of that intersection faster, like identifying what bumper stickers to avoid being behind.
And there are different ways to operate behind the wheel. I had a friend's mom who refused to ever make left-hand turns, and she was able to get everywhere she needed to go, only taking rights.
What?
Because four rights make a left.
Yeah. Two wrongs don't make a right, but four rights make a left.
Yeah.
That's incredible. I love this lady. I would love to spend a day with her. Oh, no. She's my new problematic fave.
You might feel at home in her home. Some of the stories that you've told me about your mother remind me of this friend's mother.
Well, my mother doesn't have the best driving record either, so I can understand where she's coming from.
Sometimes you just
got to
keep it simple, stupid. If you take the left out of your move set, you know, I feel like that's where a lot of mishaps happen.
Yeah.
He doesn't got a left. You know, like a crusty old robot boxing instructor would say.
Yeah.
You got to hammer them with your right, Rob.
Rob is the name of the robot?
Yeah, because it's just the robot that came with the Nintendo.
It's the NES system. Robotic operating buddy.
Yeah, he's just trying to drop discs on the other robot.
Stop. God damn it, Rob. Stop stacking those discs and fight.
This is all I was made to do.
Disqualified for bringing discs into the ring. All right, here's what we got. Untangling the dang spiderweb of deceit. An hour of howling winds and bitter groans. The suggestion box. The Rebels in the Retails, a guide to doing a bad job at a bad job. My name is Tammy Parker. The White House Situation Room. Giant Robot Fist Fight. Real Bigger Franken Podcast. And Shortcuts.
This is the odd week where I don't have a strong, super strong pro opinion of any of them or a super strong neg opinion of any of them.
Yeah.
Very difficult choice.
I feel like
We got really dramatic for our first episode titles, and then after that, it's more just normal. But
I think the only one that I really don't like is My Name is Tammy Parker.
Yeah, because that one would be a lot of work. Like, I could see us doing like a documentary style one where we try to find out who Tammy Parker is, but I honestly cannot. I'm not pouring that much work into that. I've got a lot of work to do on White House boats. Whitehouse.boats. It's really hard not to say whitehouseboats.com to me, right? Still, that's going to be a lot of the work.
It is. Someone's going to. We have to buy whitehouseboats.com before someone else does.
Yeah, we don't want anybody drinking our White House boat milkshake.
God damn it. Why is whitehouseboats.com is $1,800 a year? No! We're going to get scooped on this one. Oh, but it does say whitehouse.boats is unavailable. Nice. No one's going to get that one.
Oh, what about Boathouse Whites?
We can get whitehomeboats.com. Wait, is whitehome.com available? I should have thought of that one.
Is my old Kentucky biodome available?
Whitehome.com. It says that it's already registered. I'm typing it in now to see if there is a website. It looks like someone owns it, but they are not. Yeah. Sorry, we can't get whitehome.com.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Well, we'll be happy with our one new website. Sometimes you pop the top on one and you think, let's just keep going, but I can only go to one website at a time anyway. So,
yeah. All right. So I like the suggestion box. I like shortcuts. I mean, we could always do an hour of Howling Winds and Bitter Groans. That's a very easy one.
I almost think that that one is made to be mixed with another one.
Maybe we do the suggestion box mixed with an hour of Howling Winds and Bitter Groans. Mm-hmm. So we're crying out. We have an hour of Howling Bitter Winds where we're just complaining about
it's
workplace
waiting
grievances.
For Godot, our regional manager. He's going to come and fix all this shit. He hasn't been here in 6 months. There's a lot of shit that needs to be fixed.
So maybe we change the name to An Hour of Howling Winds and Petty Grievances.
Sure.
Folks, head on over to patreon.com/we don't have a podcast yet or whitehouse.boats and sign up to support the show. If you sign up at the $5 level or above, you will get access to the entire back catalog of attempted podcasts, as well as a new episode in your podcast app every Friday or Saturday, or sometimes Sunday. Sometimes our weekends are busy. Also go to iTunes and leave us a review. Tell your friends, follow us on social media at WDHAPY. That's been the show. Thanks for listening. I'm Nathan B. Woodard.
And I'm Andrew James Estes.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye. 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 Bye-bye.